The new moon race is intensifying with the signing of the Artemis Accords by the US and many other nations. And who isn't participating? Correct, Russia and China. Because it seems that they will launch their own manned moon exploration program. So who will win this epic new moon race? Meanwhile, NASA is awarding 14 American companies $370 million to develop technologies for the Artemis program. And of course, SpaceX is among them.
Then the Russian space agency Roscosmos and its leader Dmitry Rogozin gets criticized by, wait for it, former Russian cosmonauts. Regarding SpaceX, Starlink qualifies to participate in bidding for a $16 billion FCC fund. Then we have two upcoming Starlink launches, and of course we'll also take a look at the current developments at Boca Chica because the SN8 hub is nearing. A lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
So the new moon race is starting to heat up. 8 countries, including of course the US, have signed the Artemis Accords, which is basically a set of principles that the countries participating in the Artemis moon program are expected to adhere to, ranging from interoperability and release of scientific data to use of space resources and preserving space heritage. Many of the principles stem directly from the Outer Space Treaty of 1967 and related treaties. The countries which have signed are Australia, Canada, Italy, Japan, Luxembourg, the UAE, UK, and of course the US, which has initiated the Artemis program in the first place. It indeed seems that there's a very strong international demand to participate in the exploration of the moon. For example, the French-Italian aerospace manufacturer Thales Alenia Space has announced that it will produce 2 modules for the Lunar Gateway station as the European contribution to the Artemis moon program. The 2 modules, which are called IHAP and ESPRIT, will serve as a habitat module for astronauts and a refueling and telecoms module, respectively. We remember that the first 2 modules of the Lunar Gateway, the HALO and the PPE modules, will also be launched by SpaceX's Falcon Heavy, but in one go in 2023. So the Falcon Heavy will see a lot of action in the coming years. But of course, there are other countries which either don't want to sign or are outright excluded from participation.
And of course, you can guess who. Of course, China and the Russian space agency Roscosmos, under their quite entertaining chief Dmitry Rogozin, who is always good for some funny and over-the-top remarks. In his eyes, the Lunar Gateway is too US-centric, and as a consequence, Russia would likely not participate. However, Rogozin wants to ensure that the gateway uses standard docking interfaces so that Russian spacecraft will be able to dock with it. Quite the funny twist here. And China is outright excluded from participating in the Artemis program. Under the so-called Wolf Amendment in federal law, NASA is restricted from bilateral cooperation with China. This, of course, now leads to an interesting political situation. Russia, being bereft of its former Soviet glory days, where they were often leading the space race, now sees its chance coming to ally themselves with China as a counterforce to the US-dominated return to the moon. Only a month ago, China has unveiled their plans for a manned moon landing by around 2030, giving us details on how they are planning to do it, about which we talked in this video here. So this will be quite the interesting situation on the moon in the 2020s. China and allies versus the US and allies.
But Rogozin also has critics. We know that he has critics. Because come on, this guy is basically making one hilarious / insane comment after another. But it is surprising that he has vocal critics among former Russian cosmonauts. Maxim Surayev, for example. A Russian fighter pilot who served 6 months stays on the International Space Station in 2010 and 2014 is a really vocal critic of Rogozin and Roscosmos. Last week, he tweeted this quite funny comparison of the interior of the Crew Dragon and the interior of the Soyuz spacecraft, likening it to a trip in the first class and the economy class aboard an airplane, respectively. Zurayev took another stab at Rogozin and Roscosmos and apologized to Yuri Gagarin, posting a video of the SLS solid rocket booster test, meaning that the US space program is moving forward, while Roscosmos is stuck in the past. Okay, we understand Zurayev's logic, but it might have been more justified to attach a video of Starship. But if even SLS gets praise from a former Russian cosmonaut, you can imagine the sorry state in which the Russian space program is finding itself in. Rogozin is a very poor leader of the Russian Space Agency. He doesn't do much besides making over-the-top comments and announcements, and has even been accused of enriching himself at Roscosmos' expense. Meanwhile, independent Russian space analysts are warning that the Russian space program is entering the dark ages. We really hope that Rogozin will soon be replaced by someone who talks less and does more, you know, because else it could really be that Roscosmos will die a slow death and won't play any role anymore in future manned space exploration, which we don't want to see.
And please consider subscribing to our channel, because we are one of the few space channels out there who are not afraid to expose corruption, lobbyism, and the sometimes outright stupidity in the spaceflight industry. Oh, and we're planning to do a live stream to celebrate that we somehow managed to reach 30,000 subscribers. Don't ask us how we did it, we are amazed ourselves. So if you subscribe, you'll get notified when we will do the live stream, and then you can also ask us questions about spaceflight or other topics. So thank you very much in advance. NASA is meanwhile awarding 14 American companies $370 million to develop technologies for the Artemis program. The list is quite extensive, so we put a link to the official NASA announcement in the description box below the video. But what's really interesting here is that SpaceX received $53.2 million for, quote, large-scale flight demonstration to transfer 10 metric tons of cryogenic propellant, specifically liquid oxygen, between tanks on a Starship vehicle. SpaceX will collaborate with Glenn and Marshall. Wow! So NASA awards over $50 million to SpaceX to test the orbital refueling capability of Starship, which we know will be a key technology for reaching the Moon and Mars. Without orbital refueling, the payload to the Moon and Mars would be far too small. This technique needs to be tested because it has never been done before in the way SpaceX intends to do it. 6 Starship tankers will be needed, by the way, to refuel a single Starship. We sincerely hope that in the future, Starships will be refueled in Moon orbit, with propellant produced in situ on Moonbase Alpha. That would greatly increase the efficiency of future Starship missions to Mars, because less refuelings in orbit would be needed. Anyways, this is really good news and showing once again that NASA is secretly working towards Starship as their main vehicle for future human exploration missions to the Moon and Mars. They of course cannot say it openly, because politicians are in love with their outdated SLS, but Jim Bridenstine is playing it smart and secretly already prepares for Starship. Nicely done, Jim! Of course, we should also mention that ULA received even more money, $86.2 million, for their Vulcan Centaur. But considering how new and revolutionary Starship is compared to the Vulcan Centaur, we'd say that receiving $53.2 million by NASA is a gigantic achievement by SpaceX.
Talking of SpaceX, this month, if everything goes well and the burning engine problems as well as the scrubbing issues are resolved, we are going to see 2 Starlink launches. Starlink 13 tomorrow on October 18th and Starlink 14 on Wednesday, October 21st. After these 2 launches, the number of working Starlink satellites will be at around 900. Starlink is already being beta tested and shows quite good results with a really low latency of 20 milliseconds and up to 60 megabit per second download and 18 megabit per second upload. But these figures will of course still improve to a targeted 100 megabit per second download and at least 30 megabit per second upload. Starlink has already been used to help the firefighting efforts in Washington state, and the first Native American tribe, the Hoh tribe, which is also situated in Washington state, now has access to high-speed internet thanks to Starlink. If that isn't freaking cool, then we don't know what is. So dear mainstream media, instead of printing headlines how evil Starlink is, because it supposedly destroyed the night sky, maybe such positive headlines would also be interesting for people to know. Starlink will be a blessing for billions of people around the world who didn't have internet access until now because they live in rural areas. And Starlink qualifies to participate in bidding for a $16 billion Federal Communications Commission fund. The FCC will distribute funding to American internet provider companies under a program called Rural Digital Opportunity Fund. The $16 billion available in the auction will be distributed among internet providers so they can deploy internet in rural communities across the United States. So nice! Maybe SpaceX can get a decent share of that $16 billion.
The more money SpaceX gets, the better. Because you know, building a giant fleet of 1,000 starships to colonize Mars needs money. So every bit of additional funding SpaceX can get is certainly highly appreciated. And SpaceX is using that money wisely at Boca Chica. All three Raptor engines have been attached to SN8, so that static fire testing is imminent now. It could start actually any time now. Probably, as we know our luck, by release of this video it has already happened, but please have mercy on us because we need a day for shooting and editing these videos here. The nose cone with flaps will be attached after static fire, as Elon pointed out on Twitter. So with some luck, we really might see the 15-kilometer hop by late October, which would be really epic. Not so much has happened with the Super Heavy launch pad, but the Super Heavy high bay now has a completed roof. Meanwhile, SN10 is joining SN9 in the mid bay, where it is being stacked. SN9 is being prepared for rear flap installation. So soon, with SN9, we'll have another Starship prototype ready for action. Thanks as always to Mary, aka Boca Chica Gal, for the amazing shots. Please go and check out NASA Spaceflight's channel, link in the description. The speed with which SpaceX is building the prototypes is increasing, and it must, because else a fleet of 1,000 starships for Mars colonization will not be possible. And not only NASA is warming up towards Starship, but also the Pentagon, right? With Starship Troopers, we talked about it in the last week's video, which you can watch right here.
And we hope to see as many of you as possible in our first live stream.
This would be so exciting! So thanks as always for watching, and then I would say, on to the future!
Maxim Surev, or what? Maxim Surev, what? And we hope to see as many of you